Fossils have driven our understanding of ancient species for centuries, but DNA is changing the game.
We are walking around on DNA from the present, and if we dig down, DNA from the past.
Now a team of scientists have sequenced the oldest DNA ever recovered.
Twice the age of what we previously thought was possible.
The DNA is 2 million years old, and from it, they've reconstructed a detailed and surprising picture of an ancient world.
We could basically see this whole ecosystem come to life, and that was amazing. It was just amazing.
Eske Willerslev is a geneticist and paleontologist who helped pioneer a technique which uses ancient DNA to explore the past.
If you look around here, right, we are at the Zoological Museum in Cambridge. We see bones all over the place, and this has been the traditional way people were looking at the past. But, I mean, fossils are generally very rare.
Fossilization requires very specific conditions to preserve things like bone. And even then, paleontologists often have to be lucky to find fossils. DNA, on the other hand, is everywhere.
Every single cell, right, in the body contains DNA. And a ground sloth like this, or an elephant, they're shedding DNA all the time to the surroundings, right? So it's just, if I do like this, DNA will be on this table for me.
This is called environmental DNA, or eDNA. It's been a core part of Eske's research for decades, and is now a thriving field in paleontology. But it wasn't always.
I remember it was during my doctorate, and I went into my supervisor, and I said to him, well, I think maybe I will try to test whether DNA from animals and plants can survive in the soil, right? Because I was sitting out looking at the window, and I saw leaves fall down from the trees and a dog taking a crap on the street. The question is, what happens to the DNA? And I said, well, maybe it's surviving in the sediments. And he laughed at me and said, I've never heard anything as stupid in my life.
Now, Eske's research involves looking for DNA preserved in ancient soils.
The DNA molecules are electrically charged, and some of the sediment particles, you know, in the soil are electrically charged. So the DNA will bind to these sediment particles, and that will reduce the chemical degradation rate of the DNA.
The colder it is, the better the DNA preservation. So one of the best places to look for any ancient DNA is ground that's been continuously frozen, so-called permafrost. So in 2006, Eske and colleagues headed to Greenland in search of frozen ancient dirt.
It's what we call an Arctic desert. I mean, it's a stony area where you can just see life is really struggling to survive. And so are you when you're up there, to be honest.
The team took samples from a location known as the Cap Copenhagen Formation. These were cores of permafrost, the oldest parts of which dated back 2 million years. But when they tried looking for DNA in 2006, they were out of luck.
We tried with those techniques that were available at the time, and we got nothing, right? I mean, and the general notion at that time was, well, DNA can maximum survive for 1 million years. So it wasn't that surprising. But every time we made improvements in our DNA extraction methods or our sequencing abilities, we went back to the Cap Copenhagen samples and tried, right? And we failed and we failed and we failed until a couple of years ago. And suddenly we got a hit.
As the technology developed, the team were able to extract more and more short fragments of DNA bound to the sediment, and then to amplify these using modern day biomolecular techniques.
At that stage, it was like, whoa, we got DNA out. That is 2 million years old, right? The second whoa was, I think, when we got the animal DNA out.
They were finally able to piece together the DNA fragments and build a picture of what this ancient environment might have looked like.
We had a breakthrough, and we could basically see all this whole ecosystem come to life. And that was amazing. It was just amazing. There was mastodons running around, reindeers, geese, hares, also marine animals like the horseshoe crab, which suggested a much warmer environment, even in the sea during that time, which was also surprising.
The picture looked very different from that of modern Greenland. Mastodons, an ancient relative of elephants, were a particularly unexpected find.
No one had predicted that mastodons should be around. It's found in North America. And Greenland at that time was also an island, so it was separated from North America just as today. And therefore, people didn't think that animals like mastodons could get there, right? But it did, right? So either it must have been swimming from the Canadian islands into Greenland or potentially walked over the sea ice.
Mastodon fossils have been found in various sites in North America, but never in Greenland. And according to Eske, this demonstrates the benefits of using eDNA to study ancient ecosystems.
Paleontology, obviously, you can do more than just identify the bone, right? So if you find parts of a skeleton, you can also say things about locomotion, for example. You can say something about whether it was hurt or damaged, you know, during life, for example. DNA can't tell you anything about that. But what DNA can is it gives you information about the genetic code itself. It gives us the opportunity to follow evolution in action, basically, right? You can actually see how species are genetically evolving and changing. It also gives an opportunity to not only see it on a species level, but a whole ecosystem level.
The use of eDNA is growing among paleontologists as techniques improve, and Eske is already thinking about how to extract even older DNA.
I think it's definitely possible to go back further. I really think so. And I think so for at least one important reason. We can see that some of the DNA that is captured in the sediments, we are not really able at this stage to properly release. When we become capable of doing that, and we are working on it, obviously, then I think you will target a whole new pool of DNA, and I think that will bring us significantly further back.
The previous record for ancient DNA was 1.2 million years, and it belonged to a mammoth frozen in Siberian permafrost. So Eske's 2 million year old DNA is already a huge jump, but there may be a limit to the oldest DNA that can be recovered. Theoretically, the oldest permafrost that could still exist is 2.6 million years old. Before that, it was too warm for permafrost to form. But it's not just about finding the oldest DNA. Getting these kinds of techniques to work in different kinds of environments is another big challenge.
Obviously, in Greenland, we got the sample because it's cold. And this is good for long-term DNA preservation. So it is really a good place to start if you want to get DNA that are millions of years. Whether it will also work out in, you can say, other settings, like temperate settings, for example, I wouldn't exclude that possibility at all, because temperature, although it is important, is not the only determining factor.
Of course, the study of DNA alone has its limitations. Without the fossil record, we wouldn't know much about what these animals actually looked like. But when it comes to the more recent past, eDNA is an exciting new part of the paleontologist's toolkit.
Environmental DNA is becoming more and more a tool that people are using in order to describe communities, right? So I think it will always be, you can say, a combination of tools. And I'm sure also we will in the future see tools that I can't even imagine now, to be honest.
Even now, there are many more ecosystems yet to be explored using environmental DNA, and perhaps many more surprises yet to be uncovered.
It's great. I mean, this is why you do science, right? It's for those moments, you know, where you're just like, oh my God, I mean, it's just changing the way we look at things. And this is the dream of a scientist, right?